ओके सर, ओके सर। थैंक यू थैंक यू थैंक यू सर।
थैंक यू सर।
मैम शैल वी वेट फॉर अनदर 5 मिनट्स मैम? अड़क मलर मैम,
हेलो,
अड़क मलर मैम
सर। यस सर,
शैल वी वेट फॉर अनदर 5 मिनट्स मैम?
हां यस सर, इफ रवि सर इज रेडी देन वी कैन बिगिन द सेशन सर।
ओके 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 ओके
मैम, एवरीथिंग इज फाइन मैम, यू कैन स्टार्ट मैम।
ओके 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 सर, 5 मिनट्स
ऑलरेडी वीडियो इज ऑन स्ट्रीम।
ओके फाइन सर, फाइन सर।
மேம் வெல்கம் ஸ்லைடு ஒன்னு போட்டு விடுங்க மேடம்.
வெல்கம் ஸ்லைடுங்களா சார்? ஒரே நிமிஷம் சார், இதுல இல்ல நினைக்கிறேன் சார், மீதி பிபிடி ல இருக்கும், இதுல போடல நினைக்கிறேன் சார்.
ஓகே ஓகே,
ஒரே நிமிஷம்
சார். அழகுமலர் மேம், ஷல் வி ஸ்டார்ட்?
ஆ எஸ் சார், வி கேன் பிகின் சார்.
ஓகே, குட் மார்னிங் ஸ்டூடண்ட்ஸ், வி ஆர் ஆன் தி செகண்ட் டே ஆஃப் அவர் ப்ரோகிராம். And we have Mrs. M. Aragumalar from Thandai Periyar College of Polytechnic, Velour, and she's an active resource in the program conducted by NA University, and she has wide exposure in English language teaching at various levels. She's a vibrant personality in dealing with students. And before I hand over the session to Mrs. Aragumalar madam, let me request Mrs. Satya of English Department of Government College of Technology to formally introduce her. Satya?
Thank you.
Yes,
can you hear
yes,
me, sir?
Yes, 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 Satya.
Can I proceed, sir?
Yes, 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 Satya, you are audible.
Oh. Good morning. We welcome you all to the second day of our lecture series, webinar series on communicative English. At the outset, I would like to acknowledge the support and encouragement of the principal, Dr. Thomas, and all the participants coming to the deliberations today. We have with us Srimati M. Aragumalar, who is going to address on the topic vocabulary enrichment. A brief introduction about our resource person. திருமதி அழகுமலர் லெக்சரர் இன் இங்கிலீஷ் TPEVR கவர்மெண்ட் பாலிடெக்னிக் காலேஜ் வெல்லோ ஷி ஹாஸ் 19 இயர்ஸ் ஆஃப் டீச்சிங் எக்ஸ்பீரியன்ஸ் ஹர் எஜுகேஷனல் ப்ரொஃபைல் ஷோஸ் ஹர் இன்ட்ரெஸ்ட் அண்ட் வைட் நாலேஜ் இன் லேர்னிங் ஷி ஹாஸ் கம்ப்ளீட்டட் பிலிட் தமிழ் எம்ஏ இங்கிலீஷ் லிட்ரேச்சர் எம்எஸ்சி கவுன்சிலிங் அண்ட் சைக்கோதெரபி சர்டிஃபிகேட் இன் ஜெர்மன் சர்டிஃபிகேட் இன் ஃப்ரெஞ்ச் அண்ட் ஷி ஹாஸ் குவாலிஃபைட் ஸ்லிட் எக்ஸாமினேஷன் ஆடிங் டு ஹர் மெரிட் She was selected as a master trainer for Tamil Nadu government sponsored training of English language teachers of Engineering and Polytechnic College. She is a member board of studies M scheme and N scheme dot Chennai. She is a member board of studies in various autonomous polytechnics. Member exam audit committee dot and various autonomic polytechnics. She is a proud recipient of 7 gold medals and awards for securing first rank at university level for MA English Literature, Madras University. She has given live commentary for Republic Day Parade at Chennai, organized by Government of Tamil Nadu 2004 and 2006. She has delivered various lectures at All India Radio, Chennai. Coming to her publication, she has presented papers at various international and national level. Here is a heartwarming thing about her. She is the author of the books Viruthal Nichayam Impression. She has contributed essays to Oru Nadiyin Maranam, Ate Narayan, Confluence of Two Cultures, Aspirations, Nostalgia. So I welcome you, ma'am. Over to you, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you, Satya, madam, for those nice introduction about me. And before beginning with my session, let me thank the Almighty for giving us this wonderful opportunity. Even during a pandemic situation, we are able to meet and we are able to communicate, of course, in a virtual platform. I thank the Almighty for that. I thank the principal, head of the department, and all the staff members of the English department of Government College of Technology, Coimbatore, for giving me this nice opportunity. I thank my colleague, Dr. C. Ravikumar, who is aiding me in YouTube streaming of this session. I thank everyone. I also thank the participants now for going to make this session a wonderful one. With this note, we are going to deal with how we are going to enrich our vocabulary. So before going to the session as such, let me see what you can see here on the screen. Ohayo gozaimasu. Doso eroshiku. Ohayo gozaimasu. Can you tell me what this is? Ohayo gozaimasu. I'm greeting you all now. Ohayo gozaimasu. So I could find some students saying it as good morning. Yes, of course, it is in Japanese language. And what is the meaning for dozo yoroshiku? Dozo yoroshiku? Again, it's a Japanese word, Japanese phrase. Can you guess the meaning for that? And this is an humble request to all the participants. You kindly mute your mic unless and until you're asked to unmute and speak. Kindly mute your mic. I could still find 2 more students having their mic in on position. Please kindly unmute your mic. Sorry, kindly mute your mic. Okay, now to dozo yoroshiku. It is how are you? I hope that everything is going on well, everything is fine with you. So with this good morning note, let me go to another very important phrase which I like most. Whenever I feel very desolated, very depressed, this particular line, it gives me a sort of inspiration. So with this clue, let me try if you're going to guess what this phrase means. Ish ferlier adish. Entreder ish giviner, order ish learner. Ish failier anish. Entweder is givener, order is learner. Can you guess what this is? Which language is this? The sounds are very known. It is hard sounding words we have. Ish, ferlier, anisht. Of course, correct. I could find one person saying that it is German. Correct, it is German language. It says that I never fail. Ich verliere nicht. I never fail. Entweder ich gewinne. Either I win. Order is learner, or else I learn something. So I have, like what Napoleon said, I don't have the word failure in my dictionary. I either have success, or else I'm there in the learning process. If not today, tomorrow I'm going to win. So with this note, we are going to have a small puzzle. You could find something there on the screen. It is a puzzle. Can you tell me what it is? It goes like this. We hurt without moving. We poison without touching. We bear the truth and the lies. We are not to be judged by our size. That is something that hurts even without moving. It poisons us even without touching. It bears the truth and the lie. And that particular thing is not to be judged by its size. Let me give you a clue. It has got something to do with today's topic. I think the screen is being presented. Noah?
Ma'am, your screen is not visible, ma'am.
One second, sir. Let me check.
Please.
No, sir?
No, ma'am.
I'll stop sharing and again I'll start the thing, sir.
Please do that, ma'am. And now it is visible, ma'am. You can go ahead.
One second, sir.
Please.
Now it is okay, sir?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Very much.
Yeah. Can you tell me? We hurt without moving. We poison without touching. We bear the truth and the lies. We are not to be judged by our size. Of course, someone says it is words, correct? The answer to the puzzle is words. Words, they hurt even without moving. We have healing words, words that can heal us, and we have hurting words. So we need to be careful when we are using our words. So that is what we are going to see today. You just ignore this slide. I'll come to it later. We are going to look upon vocabulary enrichment, why words are very important, why should I learn more words. That is what we are going to see. And just now you can see something being displayed there on the slide, okay? So instead of saying one particular word adjective, I am giving you so many other words related to that. So this is going to be our objective today, our aim, our intention, our target, our goal, our ambition. This is the, I'm going to present you the schema of how you're going to enrich your vocabulary. How you can design your vocabulary enrichment. So instead of saying one particular word, I have used so many other words to tell what you expect to learn in today's class. So our objective is going to be, this is, So this is what we are going to see today. I think I got some technical issues. I'll be back. So we will be learning what is a word, why we learn more words, how many words we are going to learn, and which words to learn, and what does it mean of knowing a word, how we are going to learn the spelling, and how we are going to learn the pronunciation. So this is what we are going to see today.
Yeah.
So now let me concentrate on what I'm
talking about.
Can I ask the participants to mute their mic? Someone's mic is on. Can I ask them to mute their mic?
இப்ப நிறைய பக்கம் நிறைய பேர் ஓட்டாங்கல்ல
எஸ் So we see that a word is nothing but it is a unit of language consists of one or more spoken
ma'am you unmute your mic ma'am
Yes, sir. Let me see what a word is. A word is nothing but it is a string of letters, a group of letters grouped together, and together they have to give a particular meaning. They have to denote a particular meaning. That is what we call as a word. And now to my next slide, why should I learn more words? When I go to this particular topic, we say that why should we learn English? Why should we learn French? Why should we learn German? Why are we supposed to learn any foreign language or any Indian language for that matter? Because learning a language, it opens up a window to a new culture. It exposes us to a new culture. And you can equip yourself with knowledge about how other people are thinking, how they meet with the day-to-day demands. We can equip a knowledge with that. And a career-wise also, you can improve a lot by learning one extra language. And learning more words in one particular language, it helps us to meet our own needs, to communicate effectively with others, both in spoken and written language, to build your thoughts, to express your ideas, and you contribute your part to the human knowledge. So this is what we say, why should we learn more words? Now, how many words do we want to learn? And studies say that if you need to travel to a new place, a place where another language is being spoken, if you are equipped with 300 to 600 words, that is enough for you to travel to a new place. You can ask the people about the way to travel. You can inquire them about the hotels, the tourist place that you are going to visit. With this much knowledge, you can manage yourself. So 300 to 600 words is needed if you need to travel to another place where another language is being spoken. And if you want to have a basic conversation with someone else who is speaking another language, it means you need to have at least 1,000 words in your vocabulary list. And if you want to survive through a day, say you're going to work in a place that is not your hometown, a place where some other language is being spoken and you have to survive there. If that be the case, surveys say that you need at least 2,000 words to be known in that particular language. And for your people, students at tertiary level who are going to know, now we have joined in an engineering college and for budding engineering graduates, for you to complete your studies in a successful manner, of course, English is being the language, though the medium in which the subjects are being taught. So for you, at least 15,000 words is needed for you to be a successful student. So this is what survey say about how many words to learn. And now let me say which words I'm going to learn. I cannot learn any word that comes in a language. It is not needed for me also. If you take an Oxford dictionary, for example, the latest compilation of Oxford dictionary for English language, you can find there are millions of words being enlisted in the dictionary. But I need not master all those words to be a successful engineering graduate, to be an enterprising teacher. I need not master all those words. Which words I'm going to learn, it is going to be according to my field of preference and how I'm going to learn the words, that is what we are going to focus today. So the words that I'm going to learn comes under three categories, what we call as new word, important word and productive word. They can be opposed against a known word, a not so important word or a receptive word. Now, new word is something, no, if I'm going to say, if I'm a graduate of electronics and communication engineering, I come across so many technical words, I have to see whether that no word is a new word or it is an already known word to me. Am I aware of that word already, or it is a new word that I am learning it only today? And next, I have to decide according to the context, according to my preference of study, whether that particular word, a new word that I have come across, is an important word or not so important word. If it is not an important word, what I can do is, I can put that word in what is called as my receptive memory. See, there are two parts in your brain, what we call as the receptive section, wherein all that I see, all that I hear, all that I could sense, know through my sense organ, it goes to the receptive memory. And whichever words or whichever scenes or whichever expressions, experiences I want to share with others, it will come to my productive memory. So you have to decide whether that particular word, if it is an important word, it will go to your productive memory, wherein you can recall and use that particular word in your speech and writing, or else it can just go and be in your receptive memory, where you will understand the word if it is being used again in any context. You will just understand the word. But when it's come to writing and speech, no, of your own, we may not use that word very often. The words that we use very often, that comes to our productive memory. So these are the words that we are going to learn. And these words are called as NIP words in short. The abbreviation that we use is NIP, N for new, I for important, and P for productive. And what does knowing a word means? If I want to know a word, that means I learn the form of the word, I learn the grammar of the word, I learn the collocation of the word, and I learn the meaning of the word. The form of the word is nothing but in spoken language, it is the pronunciation of the word. And in written language, it is the spelling of the word. I should be aware of the pronunciation and also the spelling for spoken and written language. That is called as the form of the word. And as far as grammar is concerned, I need to categorize the word as different part of speech, you know, whether it is a noun, a verb, an adjective, or an adverb. The grammar that I attach to that particular word, I should also be aware of that. And what do we mean by collocation? Collocation are nothing but words are being grouped in one particular section. It goes together. We call that particular section as collocation. And meaning of the word also, of course, I need to know. Only then another term that we use for meaning is we call it as synonym. So we are going to deal in detail about all these things today in today's session. So when we come to spelling, I think there is a slide being displayed there on the screen. Please tell me if any one of you can unmute your mic and you can try reading what is being displayed there on the screen. The spelling is not correct. I mean, it is the word letters are not placed in order, but still let me try if you're able to read what is being displayed there on the screen. Any one of the students can volunteer. You can unmute your mic and you can speak.
Ma'am. Can I speak?
Yeah, of course, Da.
Only smart people can read this. Couldn't believe that I could actually understand that what I was reading. The phenomenal power of the human mind, according to the research at Cambridge University.
According it doesn't matter in what order the letters in a word are. The only important thing is that first and the last letters in the right place.
The only important thing is that the first and the last letters be in the right place. The rest can be a total mess and you can still read it without a problem. This is because the human mind does not read every letter by itself, but the word was a whole. Amazing, huh? Yeah, and I always thought spelling was important.
Okay, Miss Meena Lakshmi, that is a wonderful attempt that you have made, and you have also proved yourself to be, you know, one among the smart people. And of course, I know there are many students who could also read this, but you haven't come forward. You haven't volunteered yourself. But again, we can read this. So the research has shown that only if the first and last letter of the word, if they are in a particular place, you can anyway read the word, even if the other words are jumbled up. So this is what they have said. And now these days we are dealing with students who are digital natives. The students who are born with the knowledge of how to use the technology. So when you compare myself with my students, I take classes for polytechnic students who complete their grade 10 and grade 12 and they come to college, to a polytechnic college. So most of my students they are digital natives, and many of the technological things, like I'm not that techno savvy. That is the reason why I chose English as my field of preference. I'm not that techno savvy, but most of my students, since they have chosen a technical education as their career, they are tech savvy, and I get to know a lot of things about technology from my students. So for the students who are digital natives, for them spelling is not important, because more than what you write in a paper with a pen or pencil, you students know how to use your digital pad, keypad, either in a cell phone or in a laptop. You know how to use it, and you have this auto correction option also. As you type the word, it comes there on the screen. So now we are not going to bother about spelling much, and let me see if you could read this particular slide, though we are not going to bother about spelling. This is a bit challenging because the words are upside down. Let me see if you are able to read this also. Any one of you can unmute your mic and you can volunteer yourself and come and read what is being displayed there on the screen.
Ma'am, shall I start, ma'am?
Yeah, you can, pa.
If you can read this with ease, then you are incredibly talented at reading backwards, which is an incredibly pointless talent to have.
Okay, so I think, can I have your name, please?
I'm Kavi Priya, ma'am.
Okay, Kavi Priya, it's a very wonderful thing that you have done. So even if the words are upside down, even if we do not know the spelling of each and every word, but with our knowledge of English, our subconscious mind, it works. Our passive memory, our receptive memory, our productive memory, our active memory, all these things together, they do some sort of things and they work, and they make us to read whatever is being displayed there on the screen, provided we are familiar with some of the words that is being displayed there. Even if the words are being placed upside down, even if the words are being placed backwards. So this is what is very important to think about our knowledge of words. So I'm not going to deal with spelling much, but let me tell you why learning spelling is important. No, just a note, because you need to take your exams. And anyway, for your exams, you have to have a pen and paper test only. So let me say why learning spelling is going to be very important, because there's certain tips for you to learn spelling. You have to make an effort to learn the spelling, whether IE will come or EI will come. Is it O-U-R-U-O? No, we get confused in that. And English is a very unphonetic language. We pronounce it in a way, and we try to spell the word in a different way. It is not like Tamil. That is a very phonetic language. You spell the word, you pronounce the word in the same manner. Whereas English, it is an unphonetic language. So we have to make a cautious effort to learn the spelling of the word. And you look closely at the word, you can have a photo memory. The photo memory is nothing but whatever you see through your eyes, it gets imprinted in your mind. That is what we call as photo memory. If needed, you can memorize your words. You can write or type the words and see. You can list difficult words. And we have got many spelling competitions being conducted all over the world. So if you find any difficult words, you can list those difficult words again and again. You can go through those meanings. You can use mnemonics. We have the word Vibgr. You can use mnemonics and you can learn the spelling also. You can keep a notebook by your side. You can write all the difficult words. You can make a note of the difficult words in that particular notebook. And then and there, you can just refer to that and to refresh your mind about the spelling of the word. This is for tips to learn your spelling. And as far as pronunciation is concerned, we have something called as phonetic spelling, which you can find it in any dictionary. And these days, since we are using computers so much, the computer itself know, if you go to any website, pronunciation website in the net, it teaches you, it helps you, it aids you, it assists you in pronouncing a particular word. The sound itself, it comes if you click there on the screen, and you can just try repeating it again and again. So as far as pronunciation is concerned, you have to do only two things. First one is you should know how to distinguish the various sounds. B, P, T, D, S, S. You should know how to distinguish these sounds. Bat is different from pat. So I should know that, I should know how to distinguish this. Then another thing is you drill. Drill is nothing but you practice, practice, and you practice. So you can just listen to the word from the internet. You try to practice it. Again, you practice until you are perfect in your pronunciation. So this is a tip that we can give for pronunciation. Now, let me deal upon the word learning strategies. So what are the word learning strategies? First thing, if you want to enrich your vocabulary, you need to love words. So what do I mean by loving words? If you want to speak, if you want to express yourself clearly to others, I cannot be using the same word again and again. If I'm going to use various words with the same meaning, then people will think that I am a well-read person, that I am an educated person. I'm very good in using the language. They call a phrase for, they have a phrase for it. They say it is gift of the gap. You know how to express yourself in different words. You can do it only if you love a particular, if you love learning words, then you can have an increased exposure to English. So how are we going to have an exposure to English, and that too an increased exposure to English? From my experience, I'll tell that reading helps you a lot. You can read stories, you can read novels, you can read any books that is being written in English. It can either be, you know, in a textbook, I mean, it can either be a book, or you can also have so many e-books these days. You can go for online reading also. You can download it in your phone and you can read those books also. We have got so much of PDF version of books now. So it can either be a real book, you can take it and you can read it, or it can be an e-book. But whatever it is, you do develop a habit of reading in English. It helps us a lot. And intentional and incidental learning. Intentional learning is I love to read novels. So intentionally, I pick up a novel and I read. And through my reading, I learn so many words which I go and keep it in my receptive memory. And incidental learning is nothing but as and when I go, like whatever is being displayed in one particular language, if I'm going to see it again and again, I will be reading that things also. And those words, they go to my receptive memory. If I want to make them come to my productive memory, I have to cautiously use them in my speech and written language. And I can guess for the contextual clues. What do we mean by contextual clues? Like I read a story, I read a technical book. I may not be knowing the meaning of each and every word that is being there in the book. From the context, I'll try to guess the meaning of one particular unknown word to me. The other words there in the paragraph will somehow help me, will give me a clue to tell what the meaning of this particular word is. And I tell you, instead of reading a word, instead of learning a word from a dictionary and no by-hearting the word, learning words in the context will help you a lot as far as your memory is concerned. If I learn a word in isolation, chances are there that I may forget the word very soon. But if I learn a word in a context, I may remember the word for a longer time. So you try to learn as many words as possible. Let the words be fixed in a context. Without a context, don't learn a word. And you can use a dictionary or a thesaurus to help you in learning a word. So we all know what a dictionary is. It is a big voluminous book, something like a pillow. It has got the words of all words in a language being listed in it in an alphabetical order. If I want, I can just look into the word and I can find the meaning for it. Now, what is a thesaurus? A thesaurus is something that is like a dictionary, but with a slight difference. A dictionary gives only one particular synonym for the word, whereas the thesaurus gives me, the earlier we saw a word called collocation. So a thesaurus gives us the collocation for the word. All the words that can be associated with that particular word that will be listed there in a thesaurus. So this is the difference between dictionary and a thesaurus. In the following slides, now I'll show you the difference very clearly also. And I can also ask someone to tell me a particular word. That is what I meant by saying, ask someone. See, I'm speaking. I got struck up. I don't know what to say for one particular thing. So I can ask my friend. I can ask my teacher. I can ask any other person also to say, how do you say this particular word in English? How do you say this particular word in Telugu? How do you say this word in Hindi? I can ask them and I can get to know that also. So these are the word learning strategies which we need to follow. So now let me give you an example for the contextual clues. I have three sentences here and I've got three words. I think those words are in bold letters. In the first sentence, you can find the word vociferous. Second sentence, there is a word called pedagogical. And the third sentence, parsimonious. So now, again, I'm giving it to the students. Any one of you can unmute your mic and you can read the sentence first. And from the context, let me try whether you can get the meaning of the word or not. I think these words are new words to you. Maybe pedagogy, you might have heard that word. In the teaching learning context, we use that word. Let me see if you are able to get the meaning of the words from the context, from the sentences. The other words in the sentence will give you the meaning. So who is going to try now?
Ma'am?
Yes?
Ma'am, first sentence.
Yes, I think this is Miss Varshini, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, Varshini, you can continue.
The girl who used to be very vociferous doesn't talk much anymore. I think expressions or express the way of talking. She won't talk like that, I am thinking.
Okay, she won't talk. Now, what is the meaning for this? She doesn't talk much anymore. So what will be the meaning for this? Something to do with? She used to be vociferous, but now she doesn't talk. So what would be the exact meaning?
She might have expressed her opinion already.
She might be vociferous means being very talkative. Okay. She is very talkative. She used to be very talkative, but now she doesn't talk much more. So these two words, doesn't talk much anymore. Used to be something and now it is different. So these words together give me the clue that vociferous means being very talkative. Okay. Now to the second sentence, who is going to attempt this? Okay, someone in the chat box has put that it is very loud. Of course, it is correct. I think it is Sandhya Raj. She has said it correctly. Vociferous means being very talkative, being very loud. Okay. Now to the second sentence from the context. Let us try to grasp the meaning of the word pedagogical. Any guesswork?
Teaching.
Yes. I think this is Mukesh who is trying to speak.
Teaching institutions.
teaching institutions. Correct, Mukesh? How did you get into that particular word?
All the words are related to teaching, such kind of.
Yeah, that's a good guesswork. So we have words like high schools, kindergarten, college. So all these things, it gives me a clue that this word pedagogy has got something to do with teaching. So even if I do not know the exact meaning of the word, I need not go to a dictionary. I need not go to a thesaurus. I need not go take my phone, mobile phone or a computer and check it in the internet. What is the meaning for this particular word? But from the given context, from the clues given from the other words, I can guess the meaning of this particular word. So this way will be very useful. And now let me go to the third sentence. Who's go ungenerous? Someone has given, I think it is Anuprabha.
Not willing to spend money.
Yeah, of course. Someone has said that he is extravagant is not the correct word. Unwilling to spend money. Saranya has said and Sandhya Raj has said. A niggard or a miser, Agalia has said. It's very stingy, correct, Sweta has said. So I could find so many responses being coming in the chat box also. And of course, your answers are correct. Parsimonious means, no, being a miser. You don't, you're very stingy. You don't want to part with your money. So from the contextual clues, I can learn the meaning of a word. So this is one best way to enrich our vocabulary. So how we are going to use a dictionary or a thesaurus? And dictionary, I think, no, like 12 years of your schooling, you would be knowing how to use a dictionary. So I'm not going to go deep into that. Let me go to how we are going to use a thesaurus and why using a thesaurus is going to be very important for me. So I have a passage here. It says, two trucks loaded with thousands of copies of Rogers' Thesaurus collided as they left a Newark publishing house last Thursday, according to the Associate Press. So now, this is taken from a news article. The incident that has happened is, there is a truck carrying this thesaurus in large now, I mean this thesaurus, and it collided with some other vehicle. An accident took place. And now the person, the news reporter who has written this particular news article, he wants to express so much on the word thesaurus. So he's using the word like what would be the reaction of the witness who have witnessed the accident. They would have been aghast, amazed, astonished, astounded, bemused, benumbed, bewildered, confounded, confused, dazed, dazzled, disconcerted, disoriented, dumbstruck, electrified, flabbergasted. There are so many words he has given. And these words, they all have, no, more or less, they have the same meaning. I won't say that all the words have got the same meaning. There are shades of differences in meaning, but I can use any one of these words instead of saying that they were shocked, they were stunned, they were stupefied. So this, I get it from a thesaurus. And in a thesaurus, you can also find the antonym for the particular word also. And towards the end of the session, no, I'll be giving you the names of some websites where we have visual thesaurus also. You can just log into that particular website if you want to search any word. Like it will be very useful for you when you're writing your assignments, when you're preparing your project. I'm talking about the project report that you're going to write in your final semester, end semester. So for all your preparation, for all your presentation, using words from a thesaurus is going to help you a lot because you're going to use the word with slight different shades of meaning and it will show that you are rich in your vocabulary. So instead of using a dictionary, I ask you, I implore you to use a thesaurus, to start using a thesaurus. Okay. Now, let me say why vocabulary is going to be so important. Why it is important? Because words are the primary means of communication and improves reading comprehension in general, improves subject-specific mastery and performance. And as I said, you have to learn a lot of technical words because now you are in the first year of your engineering study. you have to learn a lot of technical words that come in your particular field of engineering, be it EEE or ECE or something to do with ICT, civil engineering, mechanical engineering, whatever may be your field of specialization. You have to master as many technical words as possible, and it improves in your reading and writing skills. And it deepens the student's ability to put their thoughts into most appropriate word possible. Okay, so these are the reasons why vocabulary is going to be very important. And if you are very good in your vocabulary, your communication skill, be it written or oral communication, you can do that with confidence. You can do that with clarity. You can communicate with conviction, with commitment, and with courage. See, if you know how to speak, if you know how to express yourself using so many words, that itself, it gives you a sort of confidence, a self-confidence. It gives you the confidence. So to communicate fluently with others, you need to enrich your vocabulary. You need to learn as many words as possible. You need to master as many words as possible. Okay. Now, I'll give you a very simple method of how you are going to learn vocabulary. So we call this as EASE method. And of course, the word EASE is an abbreviation for enunciate, associate, synthesize, and emphasize. Enunciate is nothing but if I'm going to see a new word, I'll try to learn the spelling of the word. I'll try to learn the pronunciation of the word. And after listening to the word being pronounced, I'll try myself pronouncing the word syllable by syllable. And I'll try to associate that particular word with some other thing, that is learning the word in a context, so that I remember that word for a long time. And I try to synthesize the word with already known words that I have. No, I'll put it in my productive memory and not in the receptive memory. And I try to emphasize that word as much as possible. Whenever I'm speaking in my class, I'm writing something in my class, the newly learned word, I'll try to use that word as much as possible so that it comes to my productive memory. So this is the EASE method that we are going to use. And you can learn the word by its definition, by its pronunciation. This all we have seen already. You try to use it in a context and you try to get multiple exposure for that particular word. There are umpteen number of websites available in the internet that gives you multiple exposure. We have the one particular website, that gives us one particular word. If I want to look for the meaning of the word, it gives me the meaning of the word, and I can also look into the tweets from the Twitter, how many times this particular words have been used in those tweets. So I can learn the word in a context also. Towards the end of the session, I'll give you the names of those websites. You can go and you can explore on your own self for those websites. Now, when we go to the learning vocabulary, we'll look into grammar for some time, because without grammar, we cannot locate a word. I cannot pinpoint a particular word. So now let me go to grammar. The first thing that we learn in grammar is a parts of speech. And English, as you all know, there are 8 parts of speech: noun, adjective, verb, conjunction, preposition, article, interjection, adverb. These are the 8 parts of speech. And now these 8 parts of speech can be classified into 2 groups: open word class and closed word class. So why should I know this particular distinction is because the words that come under closed word class, they are your pronoun. The words that you use instead of noun, like I, me, you, myself, those words, your preposition, in, on, to, from, for, those words, coordinators, and, but, at, because, as long as. So these words are called as coordinators. The determiners are nothing but a, and, your articles, this, that, all those words, they are called as determiners. So these group of words are called as closed word clause, because we have a limited number of words and we do not add any new word into this category from any other foreign language. And English, as we all know, it takes any word from any language and uses the word as it is. It never tries to translate that particular word. Say, for example, if I take Tamil language for that case, there is a word called computer. English language, it is a Greek word. English language has taken the word as such, as computer. But in Tamil, what we are trying to do is we try to translate the word and we say it as Kanipuri or Kanini. We are trying to translate that particular technical word. But this is not the case with English. English, no, it accepts, it assimilates words as it is from other languages also. When we come to the closed word clause, we do not have any new words being added to the pronoun list, to the preposition list, to the coordinator or to the determiner list. Whatever words we are having in this particular grammar part, they are already listed there in the dictionary. And there are very few number of words under this category. And there are not going to be any addition. So I am least bothered about these words because my 12 years of schooling, my 4 years of college study is going to give me the meaning. It's going to teach me the usage of these particular word classes. But I'm going to be much bothered about the open word class. And what are the open word class? We have a noun, verb, adjective, and adverb. So any new word that comes into English, it has to come under any one of these categories. It can either be a noun, a verb, an adjective, or an adverb. And that is why it is open to new entries. You can add as many words as possible. Even now, when I'm taking this particular session, there are many new words being added into English language, and all those words, they come under this category called as open word class. And there is one thing very special about these open classes. I can change a noun into a verb. I can change a noun into an adjective. I can change a verb into a noun. I can change a verb into an adverb. I can do it very easily by adding some prefixes or suffixes to those words. So you might have learned these things in your word formation, adding prefixes or suffixes. They can be changed from one word class to another word class by adding prefixes or suffixes. So I am not going to learn one particular word in the open class. If I come to know one particular word, I can change it into another class of word. And in that process, I will be learning a group of words together. More or less, they will be having the same meaning, but the grammatical function is going to be different. They can either be a noun, they can be a verb, an adjective, or an adverb. The grammatical function is going to be different. But as far as the meaning part is concerned, it is going to be the same. So now when I say that we are going to learn vocabulary, we are going to enrich our vocabulary, we are going to build our vocabulary, we are concentrating only on this open class of words. So again, you have to remember that if you learn a word, that particular word, if it is an open class word, it can be transformed, it can be changed into other class of words also. Now, how am I going to build this vocabulary part? So we have got two things. What is called as concrete vocabulary. The other one is called as abstract vocabulary. Concrete vocabulary, through pictures, I can learn the word. So this is a very easy way for children to learn. And even though we feel very easy. See, the picture and the word, they convey a meaning to me. Together, they convey a meaning. I need not go to a dictionary and check for the meaning for this particular word because the picture itself, it conveys the meaning for this particular word. So this is called as concrete vocabulary. We have something called as pictionary, picture plus dictionary combined together that gives you a list of this concrete vocabulary. Just by looking into the picture, you can learn the word. You need not go and look in for the meaning for it. Separately, the picture themselves, they will convey the meaning. And we have some abstract concepts also, like those words can be learned through association. Again, if you look into my example that I have given, of course, they are homophones, weak and weak. One means that it is not very strong. The another one, it means the day of the week. So what I have done is I have listed the days of the week, like from Monday to Sunday. And through association, you can learn the abstract. Even if it is an abstract word, we can know the meaning for that abstract word. So either through concrete pictures or through association, we can build our concrete vocabulary and our abstract vocabulary. Now, the another method to learn words, and when now you are in tertiary level, primary level is still your fifth standard, then we call it a secondary till your eighth standard. Then you come to know higher secondary level till your plus two. Now you are at tertiary level. The college students are called as students at tertiary level. And at tertiary level, when you are using a language, you need to use a lot of idioms and phrases. Idiomatic expressions are nothing but certain phrases that the native speakers, they use. They have been using it for long and long in the language. And if you are going to use those words also, those phrases, those expressions, then it means that you are very good in using that particular language. So when now you are in tertiary level, so I ask you to go and learn as many idiomatic expressions as possible from your chosen field of specialization. So those idiomatic expressions can either be phrasal verbs. Phrasal verbs are a verb along with a preposition, are called as phrasal verbs. Or they can be idiomatic expressions. I have given you some examples there on the screen itself. By looking into it, you can get an idea about what it is. Okay, so now let me ask you a puzzle. Once again, I'll go to that particular slide. So since we have been into too much of theory, I think we need to have a break. So you can view the picture that I have given there. It is a puzzle. It says that railroads crossing without any cars. Can you spell that without any R's? So now let me see who is going to give me the correct answer. You can look into the picture. You can look into the words given there.
Toys.
It is not toys. You can think and you can answer. You try to look into the context. Many a times, no, especially when you're going for this test or exams that has multiple choice questions, your MCQs. For those tests, no, most of the time, if you read each and every word properly given in the question, that itself gives us a clue about the answer. So now the answer is there in the words listed there on the screen. It is not elsewhere. The answer is there on the screen right before your eyes. And I have given you the clue also. It has got nothing to do with the pictures, the images. How many words are there on the screen? I think there are 12 words. Out of those 12 words, one word is the answer. The answer is there in the sentence itself. And instead of giving me the answer, I could find someone playing with my screen, annotating it. Yes. Another clue that I'm going to give you was...
Yes, answer is yes.
No, no. Agalia has given me the answer. The answer is that it is there in the chat box. Agalia has given me the answer. Well done, Agalia. The answer is that. So my question is, I'm asking, see, the first sentence has got nothing to do with the puzzle. Railroads crossing without any cars. So just to distract you, I have given you these images also with rails and cars and dashing against one another. My question is, can you spell that? T-H-A-T, that, without any R's. I can easily spell the word that without an R. So that is what Agalia has given there in the chat box. Well done, Agalia. I hope you got the answer to the puzzle. I'm asking you if you could spell the word that without an R. And of course, I can easily spell it. The spelling is T-H-A-T, where there is no there. So these are... Yes.
Ma'am, how can the answer be that, ma'am? You're asking is can you or cannot. So we have to answer in yes or no, right?
No, I'm asking you, can you spell without any R? The answer is yes. Yes, I can spell without an R.
Yes, ma'am, correct. The answer is yes, right? But you're saying the answer is that.
Okay. The answer is yes. Okay, then. You're going too logically to the question. So the answer is yes. And if they ask me to spell, then I can spell it as T-H-A-T. Okay? Can we come to this compromise? I think this is...
Yes, ma'am, we can.
Okay. Thank you, Pavitra. Thank you. So now let me go to the slide where I want to go now. I'll take... One sec. One second. Okay. I think the screen is visible now. Yes or no? Hello?
No, ma'am.
No, ma'am.
The screen is not visible?
No, ma'am. No, ma'am.
One second. I hope now it is visible.
Yes, ma'am. Now it's visible.
Okay. Let me open the chat section also. I need 3 volunteers, Pa, one after the other. You have to select any 3 words from this. And these are the words that you can use for introducing your own self. See, if I want to call myself, if I want to say some of my characteristics, I can call myself as enterprising, enthusiastic, sincere. So these 3 words I can use to introduce myself, to say something about my character. So these adjectives will help you to introduce yourself to others, to say something about your character to others. So I will take 3 participants to play this game, and you have to select any 3 words. And each word, I have given some coins, some points I have given for that. And let me see who is going to score more points. And again, I'll tell you that, I have in a random way associated the word with the points. There is no one-to-one correspondence, okay? So you can just try this and we'll play this. And let me see who is going to score more points. So I need 3 volunteers. Can I have my first volunteer now? He or she can come and pick 3 words. You say the word, I'll click on the screen, you'll be getting your points.
Can I start now?
Ma'am, can I?
I think Pavitra has started. Yes, Pavitra, you can start.
Okay, ma'am, where's the time?
One second. I got too many things there on the screen. No, let me see where versatile is. And now what is the meaning for the word versatile is there on the screen? Yeah. What is the meaning for the word versatile?
Multi-talented kind of.
Yeah, multi-talented. Very good. So I have chosen the word versatile. Then 2 more words.
Energetic.
Energetic. Okay. Then?
Diplomatic.
Diplomatic. Okay. So you have scored 7 points, okay? Then now okay, to ma'am. My second volunteer. So Pavitra, yes, Pa. Can I have your name, please, sir?
Meenalochini, ma'am.
Okay, Meenalochini.
Yes, ma'am. Can I select one?
Yeah, you can select.
Successful.
Okay. Where is successful?
Second row.
One second. I have found it. Yeah. Then?
Sincere,
okay.
Then self-disciplined.
Okay, then. So you have scored 5 points, right? 2+2+1. And now for my third volunteer.
Ma'am, I'm Kavipriya.
Ma'am? Yes, Kavipriya.
Ma'am, innovative.
Innovative.
Dedicated,
okay.
Efficient,
okay. So what's your score now? I think it is 6, right?
Yeah, ma'am.
Yours is 6. And I think Pavitra has scored a 7 and she's standing first, right? Pavitra, Kavipriya and Meenalochini, right? So anyway, thanks a lot for participating in this small game. My point is to know, make you learn these words. There are 20 words being displayed there on the screen. And all these words can be used to introduce yourself, which is going to be a sure question for your practical exam. And when you're going to take a campus interview thing, no? Like they ask you in the personal interview round, they ask you to introduce about yourself. And most of the adjectives that I have used here, you're going to use these adjectives to project a positive image about yourself. So learning these adjectives are going to be very important for you. So for that reason only, I have shown these 20 words there on the screen. And as we are playing, again and again, you will be looking into those words. So what happens is these words, they go into your receptive memory, and you can easily bring forth those words to your productive memory also. And thanks to Pavitra, Meenalochini and Kavipriya for helping me to play this particular game. Thank you. So with this, let me resume to my previous PowerPoint. 1 second. Okay, this is my own way of teaching vocabulary to my students. I follow these three methods, what is called as lexical scaffolding, visual scaffolding and e-scaffolding. Lexical scaffolding is nothing but learning words from the context by using a dictionary or a thesaurus by reading and learning, okay? Visual scaffolding is you look into the word and you get to grasp the meaning of the word and you remember that particular word. And e-scaffolding is using the technology available that we have from the internet and using that to help us in learning the word. And can you guess the meaning for the word scaffolding? I have used it thrice here and I also have a picture there. It has got something to do with the meaning of this word scaffolding. Can any one of you guess and tell me what that word is?
Ma'am, you are not presenting the screen.
Yeah, screen is not visible, ma'am.
It is not visible. Wait 1 second. Again, I'll stop sharing. I'll resume the screen once again. Is it visible now?
Yeah, ma'am, it's visible.
It is visible. Okay. So we have a image there. We have three words, lexical, visual, and e-scaffolding. Lexical has got something to do with words. Visual, what you see. E is your electronic medium, what you get from internet. Now, I am asking you to guess the meaning for the word scaffold. The meaning for the word scaffold, you can get the meaning from the image that is being displayed there on the screen.
Building,
it is in the process of building. It is not a building as such. No, it is not a complete building. you have got some support to the building. You're giving some support to the building in the process of constructing a building. Yes. So this is called a scaffolding. In Tamil, no, we call it a saram. Building keela vilama irukkirathukku kattrapo namma vandu saram kattudalnu solvom. That is what we call it in English as scaffolding. So in the 21st century, the role of a teacher, especially at tertiary level students, it has to be in the form of a facilitator or a scaffolder. They have to support the student in their learning process. I am not going to teach you something new, but I am helping you, I am assisting you, I am enabling you to learn something. So that is what we call a scaffolding. The same way for a building to be constructed, we have all these poles being erected to safeguard the building till it gets a stable structure. These pillars and poles, they are going to safeguard the building. So in the same manner, a teacher is going to be a facilitator or a scaffolder. So that particular word I am taking and I'm using it. You are going to take the help of lexical words, visual and e-content to help you in enriching your vocabulary. So let us play one particular game now. We call this game as categories. And as far as students are concerned, there are 182 participants now there in the session, including me. So you exclude me, and of course some teachers will be there. I believe you exclude them. There will be some 170 and odd students in the session, attending the session. I want all of you to participate in this. And I don't want the same set of students coming again and again, unmuting their mic and speaking. Let chance be given to the other students also. I ask others also to come voluntarily and participate when you're asked to come and speak. If you're not that very confident in speaking, you can put something there in the chat box also. I am having a look at that also. So now this particular game is called as categories. Like I told you, when we learn a word, we have to learn the word in association. So now I'm going to dictate 18 words. I'll go very slowly. I'm going to dictate 18 words to you. I hope you have a paper and pen with you. You draw three columns like this: good qualities, false, both, cannot decide. Okay. Both means whatever quality that I'm going to dictate, it can either be a good and bad quality, or maybe you're not in a position to decide whether it is a good quality or a bad quality. Okay. So you have to put that particular word under these three columns. Are you sure of what you're supposed to do? I'll be dictating 18 words. You have to assign those 18 words to any one of these three columns. If it is a good quality, you write it under the good quality. If it is both a good and a bad quality, at times, some words are like that. You put them under the third column, both. And if you're not able in a position to decide whether it is a good quality or a bad quality, again, you put it under the third column. If you think that particular quality is not a good quality, then you put it under the term false. Okay. So here am I with my first word. Absent-minded. Absent-minded. Active. Second word is active. Third word, affectionate. Fourth word, ambition. Fifth word, arrogant. Sixth word, assertive. Seventh word, boastful. Eighth word, cautious. Ninth word, cheerful. Tenth word, envious. 11, haughty. H-A-U-G-H-T-Y, haughty. 12, humble. 13, irresponsible. 14, obstinate. 15, pessimistic.
16, talkative. 17, vain, V-A-I-N, vain. And the last word is witty. Can any one of you unmute yourself and speak what you have written under good qualities? Hope I'm audible. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Okay. So what you have written under the first category is good qualities. Any one of you can unmute yourself and you can speak.
Active.
Yes, Varshini, active.
Affectionate.
Okay.
Ambition.
Okay.
Cheerful.
Fine.
Humble.
Good. So the what you have listed under false?
Absent-minded.
Okay.
Arrogant.
Fine.
Irresponsible.
Okay.
Pessimist.
Okay.
Talkative.
Talkative. So you feel that being talkative is not a good quality.
But at what situation we are talking important.
No, it depends. It depends upon the individual to categorize this. Okay, it depends upon the individual. So I agree with your categorizing the words. And can I move on to the next volunteer who is now ready to speak what they have written? Thanks a lot. I think it is Varshini, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Thanks a lot, Ra. Now, who is going to come next?
Ma'am, myself, ma'am.
Harini. Yeah, yes, Harini, you can continue. Have you listed any words in the third column, Harini, as this both and cannot identify, cannot decide? Have you listed any words in the third category, Harini?
Yes, ma'am. I've listed them.
Yeah, can you read those words first?
Yes, ma'am, I'll do it. Asserted.
Okay.
And boastful.
Okay.
Obstinate.
Fine.
Haughty.
Okay.
And witty.
So these are the words listed in the third column. They can either be good or false, or you cannot decide whether it is good or bad.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now, under good qualities?
Under good qualities, active.
Okay.
Affectionate.
Fine.
Ambition.
Okay.
Cheerful.
Okay.
And humble.
Okay. So, this is how, the categories, it depends upon our mindset, the way in which you're going to look upon the word, and we categorize that. So there is nothing good and nothing wrong in this activity. Like, I cannot say, no, why you have put this particular word under the fault section. For me, it is a good quality. Why can't you put it under good quality section? I cannot come and ask. It depends upon the person who categorizes them into the various categories. Okay. So you can have this sort of category games for your technical words also. Since I have taken qualities as my dictation words, I have categorized them. I have put them into various columns as good, bad, and cannot decide. For your technical words, you can decide upon the categories in which you are going to assign those words. And you can play these words with your classmates also as a group, you can learn. Instead of growing individually, I am going to do these things. You can grow very well if you are there in a part of a community, as a part of a group. So you can have it as a group activity and you can play among your friends. Even using your cell phones, you can play all these things. Okay. So now to my second one. So I think there are again 25 words being displayed there on the screen. I'm giving you exactly 10 seconds time. You can go through these words. And I will change the screen. You have to remember and make a list of words that you have seen on the screen. Okay, there are some 25 words there on the screen. I'll give you 10 seconds time. You can look into the screen. I will change the screen, okay? Without seeing, from remembering, you have to recall the words that you have seen on the screen. So your 10 seconds starts from now. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Okay. So can you make a list of words that you have seen just now? You write it in the paper. Let me see how many words you could recall. You can put the number of words. You need not put the words. You need not type the words. Just the number of words. 8, 10, 12. Just the number of words that you can recall. You can put it there in the chat box after writing it in the paper. You recall and write those words in the paper. Just the numbers alone, you can put it in the chat box. I can find Vishnu Janani has recalled 15 words. Great attempt, Pa. Kirtana, 16. Fine. Meenalochini, 18. 13. 20. My goodness. Okay, there are two students who have recalled 20 words. Can I ask those two or three students? Akshaya, I don't know the name of this person whose numbers ends with 117, and Jijendra Gauri. They can come and just read out the words that they have written. Any one of these three can come and read out the words that they have written.
Ma'am, this is Akshaya.
Yes, Akshaya.
So... 9. Shall I start, ma'am?
Okay. Yeah, you can start, Ra.
9. Plug. Clock.
Okay.
Swap.
Okay.
Lamp. Rank. Fine. Apple. Love. Sway. Warm. Sword. Bird. Cell. Arm, hold.
Okay, Akshaya, okay. It is very fine. And no wonder you got a placement in a government engineering college, that too at a prestigious college like GCT Coimbatore, because I think you people know, not only for Akshaya, but for many of you students, you got something called as photo memory. The thing you see in the screen or whatever you see, no, you capture it as a photo and you are memorizing that. It's really fantastic. So this is for first game. It is a series of two games. So this is my first game. Now let me go to my second game. And thanks a lot, Akshaya, for participating. Now
Thank
to
you.
My second game. Again, a list of some 25 words are there on the screen. I will give you only 6 seconds time, not 10 seconds. I'm going to give you only 6 seconds. Let me see how many words you're going to recall. Your time starts now.
Orange, table,
six,
green, table,
five,
apple, yellow, chair,
four,
orange, dog,
three,
blue, with banana, fish, pink, neon, mango.
One. Okay. So your screen is gone. Now you try to recall. I've given you the same set of 25 words. I mean, same number of 25 words, but a different set of words. But the time that I have allotted is no very minimal. For the first slide, I've given you 10 seconds. For the second slide, it is hardly 6 seconds. Now let me see how your photo memory works and how many words you are able to recall out of that 25 words. Again, you can write the list and you can just put the numbers there on the screen. You put it there in the chat box. Okay, 14, 19, 12, 18, 19. Can I display that slide for 2 more seconds? Because I think I have shown it only for 6 seconds. Whereas the earlier slide, I have shown it for 10 seconds. Can I display the slide for 2 more seconds?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Fine. Yes. Now tell me whether you could increase the number in words that you have written. And all those who have written, no, you kindly check with the previous slide that you have written, how many words you have written for the first slide and how many words you have written for the second slide. And please tell me if there is an increase in numbers between the first and second slide, what you could recall. Yes, Meena Lakshmi can remember as far as 23 words. I have displayed 25 and she could recollect 23. That's really amazing. And Hemalata and Harini can recollect 22 words. Okay. Okay, fine. So I'm not going to ask you to come and read those words to me because we are running short of time. I think we hardly have 1 hour more to wind up the session. And I've got so many other activities also to complete before that. See, in this particular slide, the first slide that we have seen, it is just a group of words. Some words are there displayed, but I could not connect one word with another word. I could not associate one word with another word. So it is a bit difficult for me to remember these words and to recall them. To see the word, to remember them and to recall. It is a bit difficult for me. Whereas in the second set of words that I have shown, I can categorize them. I can associate those words. The first row, it is about animals and birds. The second row is about colors. Third row is about furniture. Fourth row is about preposition. And the last row is about fruits. So I can associate those words and I can remember, I can recall the words very easily when I associate the word with another word. So this is helps you to learn the importance of learning word in isolation and learning word in association. If I learn a word in isolation, taniya patana, as an individual word, chances are there that I may forget the word. It is difficult for me to recall that particular word. But whereas when I learn words with association, learn with other words, when I learn a word in a context, I'm associating that particular word with the other words in the sentence. In a context, I learn the word. In association, I learn the word. Chances are there that I may recall, I may remember these words for a longer period of time. Even after, say, 8 hours or even after 10 hours, if I ask you to recall the words that you have seen on the slide, first slide, no, hardly 5 or 6 words you could recall, say after 10 hours. But whereas for the second slide, no, you can recall many words comparatively. Why? Because we remember a lot when we learn a word in association. So to prove this point, we have played this particular game, learning words in isolation and learning words in association. Now, let me come to the word that we saw earlier. We saw a word called collocation. Collocations are nothing but lexical sets, and lexical sets are word generator. Like if I say one particular word, the word goes and triggers so many other words in my mind, and those words together, they are called as lexical sets. And again, the words that are going to be triggered, no, it depends upon my mindset, it depends upon my experience, my exposure to life, it depends upon so many other psychological factors also. Say, for example, if I say the word college, what all comes to your mind? Friends, teachers, classes, assignment, exam, online teaching, you're spending time in the canteen, playing with your friends. So these things, what all I associate with the word college, that triggers in my mind when I hear the word college being uttered by someone. So these words that you associate with one particular word, we call them as lexical set. There will be an unseen string that associates one word with another word. So here I've got a lexical set. Can you tell me for which particular word I'm giving all these words? You can find some 25 to 30 words. I'm not sure about it. Some 25 to 30 words are there on the screen. And all these words, they mean one particular word. Can you give me that particular word? Prosper, laurel, accomplishment, positive result, leading, complete, rewarding, lucrative, eminence, attainment, flourish, aim, fulfillment, winning, thrive, fruitful, wow, fame, laudable, success, achievement, triumph, victory, realization. So these words, they all mean one particular thing. What is it? You can take the word from the list itself and tell me what it is.
Success.
Yeah, of course. They relate to success. So all these words relate to success or victory. When I say this word success, all these things come to my mind. So again, I'm going to another set of words. Again, they are also success, but what is needed for me to be successful? So I have written my own name here because whenever I think about success, no, the first thing that flashes upon my mind is myself. I want to be successful in all my endeavor. So I quoted one German phrase, no, in the beginning of the session. Either I win or else I learn something. So your attitude, I have left a dash here also. A space, maybe you can fill the space with your name also there. Okay. So to be successful in life, I need all these things. So for the word success alone, I have associated some 40 to 50 words for one particular word alone. So I'm not learning one word, but I'm learning a word in association, a word as a family. If I remember one word, it triggers so many other words in my mind also. Now you can recollect and tell me why it is important for a student at tertiary level to know 15,000 words. So now for the past 3-4 slides itself, no, we have covered some around 100 to 150 words we have covered so far. And so many other words would have come in your mind also. So no, the list is going on and on. So for a college student, it is important that minimum you need to learn 15,000 words. So these are what we call as lexical sets, words in association. The other term that we give is collocation. Now to what I call as visual scaffolding, visual support, visual way of helping you, assisting you, aiding you to learn to enrich your vocabulary. The techniques that we are going to use is Pictionary, infographics, poplets, word cloud, or word splash. And about Pictionary, already I told you, it is nothing but a picture plus dictionary. A picture dictionary is called as a Pictionary. It is a portmanteau word. A word, two words coined together, we called it as a portmanteau word. And this is a picture dictionary. Of course, it is about office supplies. You can just see the number and you can associate that with a word given there. You can easily learn the name of this particular object. This is what we call as Pictionary. You are not going to go into the meaning of the word, but the picture itself, it gives you the meaning of the word. The second Pictionary, of course, it is a basic level pictures only I have chosen. Just to give you an idea, we have a Pictionary for technical words also. For EEE words, we have a separate Pictionary. For ECE words, we have. For computer-related words, we have. For automobile-related words, we have. We have different Pictionaries for different technical sector also we have. This is just to give you an idea about the various verbs that we are going to use. And just by looking into the image, you can get to know the meaning of the word. And especially know this Pictionaries help you a lot if you're going to learn a foreign language. See, being a tertiary level, I cannot rely on a teacher to come and teach me daily of how a teacher of an LKG class or a standard one or two goes and teaches to the student. I need to be autonomous in my own learning. I need to know how I could learn on my own self. So for that, these Pictionaries are of great help, be it for in our own mother tongue, for in learning a second language or learning a foreign language. So this is the first one. We call this as Pictionary, and this is for electronic device. And sorry if the image is not that very clear. This is what I could get from the net. If it is not that very clear, you kindly excuse me. I'm just showing you a sample, okay? And this is for the words that we are going to use in a factory setup. Probably for mechanical engineering students or automobile students, if you're any of those students are here, this is going to be of help to you. Just by looking into the picture and the word, you can relate one to one. This is for a construction site. Just to give you a sample, I'm showing various pages from various Pictionaries. I'm showing you the images to you. And now let me have one riddle, okay? I'm the first in the earth, and I know you people are going to answer me very soon. Because I find so far that I'm dealing with the best minds in Tamil Nadu. You people are very fast in answering, very fast in finding out the answer. So here comes my riddle. I'm first in earth, second in heaven. I appear two times in a week. You can see me once in a year, although I am in the middle of sea. What am I? Okay, so as I said, this is only for give you a break or for giving myself a break. Okay, I know you people are very, very, very talented. So the chat box is filled with the letter E. That is the answer to this. So the letter E appears first in the earth, second in heaven, and it goes on like that. Okay, so thanks for all of you who have participated in this quiz. Now I'm going, this is only for a break. Okay, I'm giving for myself. Now, let me go to the second one, what we call as infographics. Again, the term infographics is a portmanteau word. Two words are combined together. One is information, another one is graphics. Anything that comes visually, it can be a bar diagram, it can be a picture, it can be an image, it can be a pie chart. Anything that comes in the visual form, we call it by the term graphics. And information, we all know what information is. When I combine these two things together, information plus graphics, it becomes infographics. You have a variety of infographics available in the internet for your particular field of specialization. So if you want to learn any particular unit, any particular topic, you just type the name of the topic with the word infographic. And you get many pictures like this. You have the information, you have the pictures there. Together, they try to convey some meaning to us. And it is very easy for us to remember and recall those points. So these infographics will help you a lot in mastering your vocabulary, learning new terms in technical English. It also helps you to learn your subject, whatever subject you're going to learn, the particular topic of the subject, to remember it and recall it at the time of exam in a very easy manner, because you know, incorporate both the information as well as the picture association. That helps you a lot in remembering and recalling. So this infographic is about the various sources from which we generate electricity. So they have given all information there itself. So it is very easy for me. I told you, you people are very smart to take a mental photo of whatever you see. So for you people and all, it is going to be very useful. Just look at the infographic. You remember the whole thing, the whole essay you remember. Even you can try to take your notes for a particular subject, for a particular topic in the subject, for a particular unit. You can have your own infographic. You are going to take notes for a particular subject. Do it in the form of an infographic. Have some pictures in it. Have some graphs in it. Add it to some information. So this will be helpful for you to remember and recall that particular question when you are going to write your exam. So this is another infographic for electricity. Just I'm giving you a sample. You just type the word infographics. It comes there in the internet along with the topic that you want. And the next thing that we are going to see is poplet. Now, what is a poplet? Anything pops in your mind looking into the word? When we go to a cinema theater, we love eating popcorns, right? And what is a popcorn? A corn that pops when too much of heat is given to it. What is popping? Whatever jumps and comes to your mind. Jumping and coming to your mind, that is called as poplet. So this is nothing but a sort of what we call as mind map. So I am giving you a mind map about what Earth is. It is about the Earth. All the information that comes. See, now we are not going to look into one single word, but we are going to look into phrases. So vocabulary enrichment doesn't mean that I'm going to lean only word after word. It can also be phrases, because a sentence is nothing but words combined together. Words are the building blocks of a sentence. So now slowly from a word, in an individual word, we are moving to sentences, or to put in more precisely, we are learning clauses and phrases. So this is what it comes in my mind. It pops in my mind when I think about Earth. So all these information, it comes to my mind. So this is called as a poplet. A poplet is nothing but a mind map. Again, for your particular subject, you just type the name of the subject, the name of the unit that you want to learn, the name of the particular question for which you need an answer. You type the word poplet next to it. You will get mind maps like this. And again, this is a very useful method for you to remember and recall things very easily. And this one is a poplet about a purposeful teacher. A teacher can be reflective, interactive, resourceful, is a good manager. A teacher is knowledgeable, connection making. They motivate you a lot. They are flexible. So these are some of the aspects of a teacher. Okay, now what is a word cloud or a word splash? We have seen words, a group of words like this. They are like a cloud. A cloud doesn't have a particular shape or structure. It assumes any shape. So you are going to place words in any shape. There is no structure or whatever it is for this. I am going to have a group of words. Of course, those words, they relate to one particular topic, one particular title. Earlier, we saw lexical sets. No, the same thing. I'm giving it to you in the form of a cloud. They are also called as word splashes, because if I splash water, it takes any shape. It assumes any shape. So in the same way, we have a word cloud or a word splash. Again, this is going to be very important for all your pre-learning activity. Say, for example, I'm a triple E student and I need to learn one particular lesson in my subject. So what I'm going to do is, I'm going to select those paragraphs that are given there in my textbook. There are various websites through which I could generate these word clouds or word splash. I just need to paste those paragraphs in the dialog box given there in the website. And what happens is I have to click and a word cloud like this will come. So all the important words that are being used in that particular paragraph, the paragraph may be for 500 words or even for 1000 words, excluding all your other open class, I mean, closed class words, you know, like your preposition, pronoun, your determiners, excluding all those things, looking only into the open class of words, you know, noun, verb, adjective, and adverb. Only those things are going to be taken into a word cloud. This is computer, it analyzes that paragraph and the words of being used in more frequently. That particular word will be shown in big font. You can use different colors. And the words that come in very small fonts, you know, it means those words are being used only once or twice in that particular paragraph. The words that are being used very frequently in the paragraph will be given in big bold letters, in bigger fonts. So I can create my own word cloud or word splash, and it again helps me to remember only the main words in the particular paragraph. It helps me to remember those main words, and I can now write any number of sentences using these main words, and I can recollect, I can recall what comes in that particular lesson. So this is a very easy way to remember words, to remember a particular unit, to learn something also. So we call this as word cloud or a word splash. Now for e-scaffolding, I told you, no, we have various websites through which we can get support for our vocabulary enrichment, to master vocabulary. So for word cloud, you can use the website called Woodle, WordShift, Word Generation, Word It Out. We have many vocabulary games, like so many puzzles also we saw, right? So it all helps you to remember something. So you can play many vocabulary games in these websites, using these websites. You can use this word reference tools for your dictionary, for your thesaurus, to find the synonym, antonym for a particular word. We also have language translators wherein, no, you have to just key in one particular passage in English and automatically the translation comes in another target language, be it Tamil or Telugu or whatever it is. But as far as this translation part is concerned, you have to know, once check and recheck what it has translated, because it is only the machine translation that is taking place. And many jokes, no, we have using this translation thing also. At times, machine may go wrong. So as far as this translation part is concerned, you have to be a bit cautious. Don't go by the translation, whatever the computer or your mobile phone has given it to you. Have a second check on that also. Okay. The other things, you can just go by the websites, whatever I have shown you here for e-scaffolding. So with this, now we are going to go to some reinforcing. What is reinforcing? I read something, I need to remember it. Say, now I have read something, I can remember it for 5 minutes, for 10 minutes. Maybe evening when I ask you something, you can recall and tell me. Say after a week, say after a month, if I'm going to ask you what I have taken in today's class, chances are there that you may not remember all the words or all the things that we have done in today's class. So in between today and the day when I'm going to ask you the question, we need what is called as reinforcement. Reinforcement is nothing but you are going to do the same thing again and again, so that it helps you for remembering and recalling. So now I have learnt a word. It goes to my passive memory. It goes to my receptive memory. Only if I'm going to use it again and again in my spoken or written language, that part is called as reinforcement, and only then that word will come to my productive memory. So for this the word that I have learned, it is a new word. It is an important word. I need to have that word in my productive memory. So what I am going to do is, I am going to follow so many activities that helps me to reinforce that particular word. So one particular thing is called as word scrambler, wherein the spellings are interchanged and you have to find the correct spelling of the word that you have learned. A word generator is nothing but a lexical set or a collocation set that we have seen earlier. A word wall is something, you list out the words that you have learned from a particular subject, from a particular lesson. I told you about word cloud and word splashes. No, like that you can take a list of words, you can paste it in the wall, either in your classroom or in your house, you can paste it. So whenever you pass by the wall, you will be looking into those words. Either consciously or unconsciously, we'll be looking into whatever is being displayed there on the wall. So what happens is automatically these words, they go into your subconscious mind. So you can have a list of words, say for 4 days or for a week or for a 15 days, something like that. No, as long as you're going to remember those words and you're confident that those words have gone into your productive memory. So you can also have this in your classroom. You just allocate one part of the wall in your classroom for this. You can have a word wall. In my college, in my lab, I have a word wall like this. So that every week, once I post some posters there with some vocabulary items, so the students who come there, they look into those particular words and in a subconscious manner, they are learning some new words also. And we have a word wheel. We are going to play a game with that. Vocabulary square is something so close to word wheel. I'll show you what it is. And by doing some puzzles also, we can reinforce what we have learned. So this is the image of a word wall. You can design it in the way that you like most. You can be very creative in that. This will be useful when you are preparing for your exams. For all the questions that you have learned, that you have to learn, you just take the main points alone. The main points, again, they are going to be a list of words. You paste them in the wall. You paste them somewhere where you are going to see it very often. So this is called as a word wall. And now we are not going to do any activity on that. Now I'm going to take a passage from a newspaper. And we are going to see how using the various methods that I have enlisted earlier, like in this particular slide, I have enlisted you some techniques, some activities through which you can reinforce your memory. So using these techniques, let me see how am I going to deal with a passage taken from a newspaper. For you, for practice, you can either take a passage from newspaper or you can take a passage from your textbook, be it of any subject, you can take it from your textbook. So these, I have taken a word cloud. I have generated a word cloud out of the sentences in the passage. So this is what the word cloud has come. So I can see something about disinfectant. It is very bold. I can see something about COVID, Trump, president, and there are so many other words. So anyway, now we are going to read what the passage is all about. I will just click on the audio. If the audio is not heard properly, you just comment it in the chat box.
Doctors warn against disinfectant as coronavirus cure. This is BreakingNewsEnglish.com. Doctors around the world have issued strong warnings for people not to use disinfectant to treat coronavirus. Their plea follows suggestions on Thursday by US President Donald Trump that disinfectant could potentially be used to treat COVID-19. President Trump said, "I see the disinfectant where it knocks the virus out in 1 minute. Is there a way we can do something like that by injection inside, or almost a cleaning? It gets in the lungs, and it does a tremendous number on the lungs." On Friday, Mr. Trump said his comments had been made sarcastically. The White House press secretary said the media took the comments out of context and ran with negative headlines. Disinfectants are hazardous and toxic substances. They can be poisonous if ingested and have fatal consequences. Reckitt Benckiser, maker of the best-selling disinfectant Lysol, warned that its product should, under no circumstance, be injected or ingested. The president of the American Medical Association also joined in the chorus of concern regarding President Trump's comments. She said, "It is unfortunate that I have to comment on this, but people should under no circumstances ingest or inject bleach or disinfectant." She added, "Rest assured, when we eventually find a treatment for or vaccine against COVID-19, it will not be in the cleaning supplies aisle."
Okay, so you have listened to the passage, and I do believe that in the process you have read what is there shown on the slide also. So both you have listened as well as you have read the passage. Now I've got some 12 sentences wherein I have scrambled some words. I have underlined those words. So can we have the help of the participants to get the words spelling correct? So the first one is dash strong warnings. And these are the letters that come in the word. Can you scramble it? Unscramble it and tell me what the word is. I have scrambled the letters. Now you have to unscramble it and tell me what the word is. Either you can unmute your audio and tell me, or you can put it in the chat box. Whichever way is convenient to you. There are 12 words I have scrambled. Okay, the first word is issued. Varshini has put it in the chat box. Issued strong warnings. See, instead of asking the scrambling words in isolation, I have put them in a group of words so that from the context itself, you can get what this particular word is. It helps you. It gives you a clue about this particular word. So again and again, I'm telling you, don't learn word in isolation. Try to learn words in association. Okay. So now to the second sentence, second word. Disinfectant to dash coronavirus. I believe that you people have become so hungry. Yes, Harini has written it is treat another person. I don't know who it is. Okay, some 2-3 students have told that it is treat. Correct. Now to the third word. I know you will be very exhausted after the long session, and many of you might also feel hungry now, but we have a Thirukkural, no sevikunavillada podu siridu vayitrukku eppadum. So kindly bear with me for another 20 minutes. Okay, so I'll wind up my session. Now to the third sentence, third word. Something like that by, can I show you the passage once again? Yeah, I'll go to the previous slide. I'll show you the passage. Don't try to annotate anything there on the screen, okay? Okay, now to the word scrambler thing. The third one is injection. Okay. Injection. And now to the fourth word. It is a dash number. You can get the clue from the words that are there in the sentence. Okay, tremendous, fine, fantastic. So many have come with the correct answer. Now to the fifth one, the White House Press dash. White House Press Secretary, okay? That is the fifth one. Okay, I could find some have come with the answer also. Sixth one is very simple, dash headlines. Now we are in the sixth word. Dash headlines, negative headlines, very good, fine. Seventh one, seventh one is hazardous, disinfectants are hazardous. Eighth one, toxic. It is very easy. Eighth and ninth are very easy. Toxic substances, fatal consequences, joined in the chorus of concern, vaccine against COVID-19, the cleaning supplies, ale. 12th one is ale. Yes, I could find some of you.
I can't see any word underlined, ma'am. You're just showing the passage itself.
This word scrambler slide is not shown to you?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
The passage alone is shown. Okay, I'll do one thing. I think there is some connectivity issue. I'll stop sharing again and start from the beginning. Now I think it is visible. Okay, I could find many giving me the answer. Okay, this is for word scrambler. Now let me go to the next game or activity or technique, or what we called as word generator. You just think and tell me, okay. So in this passage, we have come across two words. One is COVID, another one is disinfectant. We'll go one word after the another. What all the terms that comes to your mind, the triggers in your mind, this word COVID, what all the triggers in your mind? You can unmute your mic and you can answer me.
Pandemic.
Okay, virus.
Virus.
Pandemic, okay. Vaccine. Quarantine. No one is saying about, okay, lockdown, good.
Cold, cough.
Then, Corona, lockdown, fever, tired, no sense of smell, doctor's symptoms,
China.
Then doctor's holiday, very good. Are you enjoying your holidays? Isolation, safety measures, social distancing, quarantine. Mask, coronavirus disease, precautions, sanitizer, news headlines. Okay. Online classes, hand wash, pandemic, China. Okay. Face mask, bat, mask. No semester. Very, very fine. Test. See, the words, no, they change their meaning also. Positive is the most negative word that we use these days, no? A positive test is the most negative word that we don't want to hear that word also. Google Classroom, doctors and farmers fame, online classes, contagious, cancellation of exams, okay. I'll put a word to the Vice Chancellor, to the CM also to cancel all your exams. Google Classroom Zoom 2020. Okay, so let me see what words that have come into my mind when I think about this. Of course, many of the words you have written here. These are the things that came into my mind when I saw the word COVID. So I think there are around some 45 to 50 words there on the screen. So these many words, they came into my mind, and many words you have also know supplemented to the list. So this is what we called as word generation. You would learn a word, that word generates so many other words that can be associated with this particular word. So this is what we called as word generation. So we'll move on to the next technique or the next activity. This activity is called as a vocabulary square. So we need to do some grammar thing also into it. So you can play this vocabulary square with your classmates, especially, you know, when you are learning a technical word. To remember, to recall, to reinforce what you have learned, you can use this particular technique called as vocabulary square, wherein you divide the page into four columns, the definition of the word, draw the word, write a sentence, and the antonym. So you give the particular word here. Say, for example, if it is COVID, I write the word here. The definition for the word, I will write it here. It is a type of disease, a respiratory disease. If possible, I could draw something that reminds me of the word COVID. I can write a sentence using the word COVID. I can also give the antonym to that particular word. Maybe for the word COVID, the antonym would be healthy, being strong, something like that. Okay. So this helps you to remember the word that you have learned. So this is what we called as a vocabulary square. A still extended form of that particular activity, we call it as a word wheel. In the square, we had only four things to do. Whereas in a word wheel, you can introduce as many number of no spokes to the wheel. Here, I believe there are seven different columns. I need the synonym for the word, the parts of the speech. Of course, COVID is a noun, name of a disease. You have to draw it or you can enact it. Something that we do like damsharats. You can give me the antonym. You can give me the rhyming word for that. You can use the word in a sentence. So I can add upon so many other activities to be associated with this particular word. And this is what we call as a word wheel. So now you could find there are 10 words. It is in the form of a synonym match. Okay. So first, I'll give you, say, 1 minute time. You try to match the word with their synonyms here. So the word for issued, I think it will be... I think it will be sent out. Okay, the synonym for issued will be sent out. Like that you can find for the other 9 words. See, this is not the activity. Okay, this is only a pre-learning part that you are going to do for the activity. So you have to match this word with its synonym given there in the this particular column. After this, we are going to the real game. So I have got a word wheel for you. We are going to play that. So I'm giving you 1 minute time for you to get the answer for these words, the synonym for these words. Maybe we can do it for the first 3 words alone, Pa, because we are running short of time. We'll do it for the first 3 words. For issued, it is sent out. For plea, I think it is appeal. For treat, deal with. Okay, so for issued, we have got the meaning for this. So what I'm going to do is, I will spin the wheel. I've got some alphabets here in the wheel. Where, under which alphabet the wheel stops, the student whose name begins with that particular alphabet, you are going to come and play the game with me. Okay, so let me start spinning the wheel. Do we have anyone in the name Yum? I remember seeing one Meena Lokshini being very active, both.
Yes, ma'am.
So, Meena Lakshmi, you are ready to play the game, right?
Yes,
so thanks again and again for coming and helping me, assisting me and volunteering yourself. So this is what you have to tell me, okay? So the word, you can select the word, but we have seen three words, issued, plea and treat. Which word you want to select?
Issued.
Issued. Okay, so I will spin the wheel now. If it is a synonym, if the wheel stops in synonym, you have to give me the meaning, part of speech, antonym. You're going to define. Define is nothing but you're going to explain the word and you're going to use the word in a sentence and you're going to give me the different word forms for it. Okay?
Okay, ma'am.
Okay. So say, for example, if the word is teach, I'm just giving you an example. The different word forms will be taught, teacher, teaching, teachable. So these are the other word forms for this particular word, teach. Okay? So like that, you have to say for issued. Right. So shall I start spinning the wheel?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, you have to use it in a sentence. That is where it has stopped, right? The wheel has stopped. Yes, you can use the word issued and frame a sentence.
Okay. I issued my ticket.
Okay, I issued my ticket. A very good attempt that you have made. Thanks a lot, Meena Lakshmi. Can I take the help of one more volunteer? Okay. Let me spin the wheel and find who is going to come. Do we have anyone whose name begins with S? You have to volunteer yourself. No. Okay, I'll spin the wheel again. Okay. Do we have anyone in the audience side whose name begins with K? If you come fast, we can complete the class very fast. Any case? Hey, you people are not interested to play this game, huh? Okay. Without this, anyone else who wants to volunteer yourself? We'll just play for one more time. Any volunteers? No volunteers? It's so sad, pa. Okay, then. I'm moving on with the next activity. By the way, what's the time now? We still have half of 20 minutes, no? Okay. So this is going to be the other activity. And again, I rely on the volunteers' support. You have to actively participate. There is no other go for me. There is no other go for you. We have to complete the session successfully. So here I have given two words. For each blank, you have to tell me which word is the correct word to be filled here. Who is going to volunteer yourself? Maybe we can do it for the first three words alone, okay? Not for the entire passage, but we can do it for the first three words. Hazard, hazardous, factually, fatal, under, over, no circumstance. So for these three alone, we'll play. Who is going to volunteer yourself?
Ma'am, I'll do, ma'am.
Yeah, of course, please. And thanks a lot for volunteering yourself.
No, yeah, it's okay, ma'am. Disinfectants are hazardous.
Okay.
And they can be poisonous if ingested and have fatal consequences. And the third word is under no circumstance.
Okay, fine. Very good. So these are the words with the other forms. Like here I have used a noun as well as an adjective. Again, in all the things. Here I have used with the preposition. So you can have a paragraph or sentences like this wherein the different word forms of the same word is used, and in a sentence grammatically we can see which particular word form fills in correctly. Okay, this is for word forms. And now, as I said, no, like I will help you in some of these websites. So there is one website called as Word Hippo. Let me see if I could go to this website. So this is the website called the Word Hippo. You have to type the word and it gives you the thesaurus. I mean, it is a visual thesaurus. You can see the picture also for this particular word, and it is very helpful in learning a particular word. So let me take the word envious. Okay. So it gives me the various, is my screen visible? Audience?
Yes, ma'am, it is.
Yes, ma'am.
The website is visible, right? The website page is visible, right? Okay, then. So I have typed the word envious, and this is what it say. It shows in the screen on that particular website. I do get the various words that can be associated with the feeling of being envy. Adjective form is there. So just
the website is not there, ma'am. We can see only the links.
The links alone is there, huh? Wait, let me see how to share that. I'll stop sharing here and I'll go to that. One sec. Can you see it now? Is the website page being shown there on the screen?
Yes,
you can find hippopotamus there on the screen. The website is called as Word Hippo. So what I'm trying to do is, I have typed a word called confined. I'm going to find the meaning. So just I have keyed in the word. So it shows me other adjectives for the word confined. It comes in the sentence also. There is one box called as more. If I click, more number of words will be shown to me. So the various forms for the word confined, for the meaning confined, is shown to you there on the screen itself. So I can use any of these word, and I can use, instead of writing, no, I'm say, for example, I'm writing one essay, and instead of writing the same word confined again and again, I can use any of these words, no, and I can fill the pages in the essay. Right? So this is one website. We call this as Word Hippo. There is another website called as WordNik. So what am I going to do is, I will write the word talkative here. Okay, this is WordNik, WordNik. You can see the web page, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So the definition is given there. Various adjectives are given there. And here you can also find, no, in literature, where all the word talkative has been used in all the books, know that it has been used. The internet has taken me all those sentences, those phrases, and it gives me, and the list is very endless. It goes on and on. So what happens is, I can also get an idea about how to use that particular word in a sentence. The usage of the word in a sentence, I can also get to know. So this particular website is very useful. I can get the relative word also. The synonym list is given there. The antonym is given there. Equivalent is given there. In the same context, what other words I can use. And They have given me many new words also they have given. So very easily know, like just one word a day, I can enrich my vocabulary like anything. I'll be not only learning one word, if I learn it this way, I'll be learning say 100 or 150 words a day associated with that one particular word. And this is a very easy, interesting, fun-filled way to learn words. So this is Wordnik, the website name is. And then I'm going to what is called as WordSift. WordSift gives me the word cloud. Okay. It gives me a word cloud. I think I've already keyed in a word there. It has given me the cloud. And it has also given me the word map. I think school or education, something like that, I have given there in the word to find the meaning. And you can also find visual images for that particular word. I think I have keyed the word school. So I got, is my screen visible, right?
Yes,
my screen is visible. Okay.
Yes,
so I can see a word cloud. I can see a word map like thing. I can also see some visuals associated with school. The various scenarios that can be associated with school, I can see from the website itself. And for those who are very good in visual learning, learning very easily by looking into pictures and images. For those students, this website will be very useful. So the name of the website is WordSift, S-I-F-T, WordSift. And the next one that I'm going to go is VocabHead. And this website is a very interesting website. So what I'm going to do is, they have got a list of words here. So let me select the word. What shall I select? Let me select the word bombastic. So it shows a small video for 37 seconds can be played. It is here if I click.
The word bombastic means to be characterized by grand dramatic gestures, inflated.
So you can listen to what they say about the word bombastic. They give you the definition, the explanation for that particular word. And also you have
and overblown.
You had an image about the word earlier, what it means. From visually also you can learn, you can just follow the video, you can get the meaning of the word, the synonym is given there, the antonym is given there. And of course, the usage in a sentence is also shown to you there in a small dialogue box there. So this is also another way, an interesting way in which you can build your vocabulary. And there is another yet very interesting thing that we are going to see. And this is what we call as freerise.com. This is an initiative taken by the United Nations organization. So there are two things involved in this. First thing is you're going to play a vocabulary game. Say some 10 or 20 words will be given and you have to find the meaning from the list of words shown in the options. And every time you click on the correct option, that is if your answer is right, this bowl of rice will be filled. And when the bowl is full, that will be contributed to the people there in the affected parts of Africa, Latin America, those areas. You are also going to fund this particular bowl of rice without paying the money, just by playing the game. It is going to be your contribution to the economically deprived people who are there at Africa or Latin America or countries like that, what we call as the third world countries. So this game is an interesting game. You check the vocabulary that you have learned, you play the game, and at the same time, you're also contributing something free of cost to the people from economically deprived countries. So let us play the game. What does permission mean?
Authorization,
okay. Slender,
thin.
So as and when I fill it with the correct answer, you can see the bowl getting filled up. Gibberish.
Babble.
Means babble, correct. Quiver means tremble. Okay. So you can also play this, and at the same time, you will also be giving your contribution to others who are there in the world. Okay, so I have shown you, I think, some 5 websites. I'll give you the link of those websites again if you want to have those names. Let me close this and share my screen again, once again. I hope my screen with the names of the website is visible now.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So you can copy the link of these websites, and you can now enrich your vocabulary. Like, instead of going and reading books, this is in a very playway method, in a very interesting manner, fun-filled activities and techniques. Just like that, you can build your vocabulary. You can master as many words as possible. And I think with this, no, I'll take leave from you. And I really enjoyed the session today. And before winding up the session, I've got only one more game for you. Just to recall, revise what we have learned from morning till now. So let me play the dice. You can tell me if number one comes, you have to tell me what you want to remember from this particular session. Or instead of playing, I can ask any one volunteer to come and tell me what they want to remember from this particular session. Have they learned anything useful today? One word to sum up what they have learned. Something that they already knew that has been told in today's class, so that it's a sort of revision for you. Something that you still know, you don't have a clear picture about it. You are still confused on that. And one aha moment, the moment that you enjoyed a lot in today's session. Can I have volunteers? This is a sort of assessing myself as a trainer, how far I have fulfilled my portion in handling this session. And the work for you is how far you have, you could recollect, recall, remember what we have done in today's session. Okay. So who is going to volunteer now?
Me, ma'am. Can I, ma'am?
Yeah, of course, Pavitra. Yes, Pavitra. Pavitra,
what you do, ma'am? Yes, ma'am. Tell me, ma'am.
Appa, you can talk on any one of these 6 points, da.
That our moment is free rice thing, ma'am. I really loved it, and I don't know.
Okay.
Really great. We can donate just by telling the correct answers. It's really nice.
Okay, then. Okay. Do you want to try the other things also, or can I ask some of your friends to do that?
Yes, ma'am. We can others, ma'am.
Want yeah, thanks a lot, advice. Pavitra. Thanks a lot, Pavitra. So who is going to come next?
Ma'am, I'll come.
Yes, Pa. Sudhantra.
Yes,
your
ma'am.
Your name sounds very interesting, Sudhantra. Yes.
Thank you. I want to remember this, I think some 3 to 4 websites taught us, and they were really nice. And also something I learned today is that word wheel and that. So it was really nice, and it was really interesting session. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Sudhantra. Then I still have 4 more questions, no? I'm waiting for the participants to come volunteer themselves and say something on these 4 questions.
Ma'am, I will, ma'am.
Yeah, of course. Please.
Ma'am, that something I already knew. I knew that the word hippo. I knew that website. My English teacher
okay.
used to give me a word. And
okay,
used to
okay. That's
all
fine.
Those.
Yeah, that's fine. That's
Thank
fine.
You.
Yeah, Mehrun, that's very fine. Then?
Yeah, that's all.
Yeah, yeah. Thanks a lot, Ra. Thanks a lot. We still have 3 more things to be completed. Something I learned today. One word to sum up what I learned. I'm still confused about. Who is going to volunteer?
Ma'am.
Yes.
Ma'am, Meena Lakshmi.
Yeah, Meena Lakshmi.
Ma'am, something I learned today is that I learned lots of new words which I doesn't know. Today,
okay, fine, fine. Then. Thanks a lot, Meena Lakshmi. Okay. One word to sum up what I learned. Just by giving one word, you can say any word to sum up what we have done in the last 2.5 hours. We started at 10 sharp, right? Now it's going to be 12:30. So in these 2.5 hours, what all we have done in one word, if you could sum up, you can tell me. You can also say that it is very interesting, it is boring.
It's like watching a Bruce Lee movie.
Pardon?
It's like watching a Bruce Lee movie.
It's like watching a Bruce Lee movie. Okay. So can I take it as a compliment? Yes. Thank you for that. Yes. Okay. So let me go to my last slide. Okay, I'm going to leave you people. So this is called 3, 2, and 1. So three things that you have learned today, can you can list it out. Two things that you still want to learn and one question that you have. You can ask me the question. And with that, I'll be answering your questions and we'll wind up the session. Okay, then. Three things that you have learned, you can just enumerate. We have done so many activities, so many theoretical things also we saw. You can just give a list. Just three things that you have learned. So who is going to volunteer now? If you finish this fast, then we can wind up the session soon. Yes, Neha, I think she's about to say something. Yes, Neha?
Yes, ma'am. I would like to say that I came to know about the many words which I didn't know earlier.
Okay.
More than the words, I came to know about the meanings and about the uses of the words.
Fine.
And I also came to know that the reverse way that we could we could read the words and that the how our brain actually works.
Okay. So you find that thing very interesting.
Yeah, I really found that thing interesting. Okay. And the two things which I would still want to learn is like I would like to know the meaning and the uses of the words in paragraphs. Something like in essays and in story writings or how to use the words in writings. I really want to know about
That you can do snake up the exploring research that I have given you, know, except for that free rice. You can explore it by yourself.
I'm sorry to say, ma'am, but your voice was so breaking that I was not able to understand any part of it. I'm sorry to say that.
Yeah. Hello, ma'am.